I'm really thrilled to be introducing Joanna Rakoff tonight to read from and discuss her book, My Salinger Year. I'm both a memoir junkie and a huge fan of Joanna's first novel, so I was really thrilled to get my hands on an early galley of this book when it first began to circulate, and I pretty much devoured it and recommended it to everyone I knew. So even though that was about a year ago, I find myself reflecting on the book often, and I was thrilled to be able to get her to DC for the paperback launch. As the title suggests, and as you surely know, this is the chronicle of a year in a young woman's life spent as an assistant at an esteemed literary agency in New York in the mid-1990s, where, when she first began to work, she was given a comically elliptical set of instructions about how to manage any queries or correspondence concerning a certain client named Jerry. It's a charming, funny, evocative book that, while set only about 20 years ago, reads like something from another era entirely, given the eccentricities of this agency as it clung fiercely to typewriters at the cusp of the computer age. It's also a very touching coming-of-age story about a young woman finding her way in New York, just out of college, trying to get a start in the publishing world while wrestling with money woes, job angst, and a narcissistic boyfriend. My Salinger Year was an international bestseller, and it garnered wide acclaim, as did her first novel, A Fortunate Age, which won the Goldberg Prize for Jewish Fiction by Emerging Writers. Please help me welcome Joanna Rakoff.
Thank you so much. I'm so thrilled to be here for so many reasons. In part only because I almost didn't make it here. There was a huge storm in Boston, and my flight was delayed for hours, and I had this feeling of like, oh my God, I'm never going to make it there, and I'm just going to sit in the airport all day, and then finally all was fine. So I'm particularly happy to be here. Okay, so My Salinger Year, you know the basic setup. I am going to read from three brief sections and ramble onto you in between them so that things make sense. So as Susan explained, My Salinger Year, as the title would indicate, takes place over the course of one calendar year. In one of those, people sometimes say to me, you're so lucky that this, you know, you had this finite subject for a memoir that it, you really worked there for 1 year. But to make it even more neat and tidy, I started working there right after the new year. So it really was actually one calendar year, 1996. And the book is divided sort of into seasons, because I was reading a lot of Japanese literature when I was writing it, so that seemed like an appropriate thing to do. So I'm going to read from sort of three of the four seasons. Okay, let me just see if there's anything you need to know. Basically, this first little section is, it takes place on my first day of work. And what has happened prior to this moment is that I've arrived and had no idea what to do, and was handed by my boss a bunch of cassette tapes, and asked and said, you know, do you know what a dictaphone is? You know, as if I should know what a dictaphone was. And do any of you know what a dictaphone is? Okay, that's actually kind of a lot. Sometimes I ask this, when I read this section, sometimes I ask this question and everyone is like 12 and they look at me like, wait, what? And then so, and then occasionally, like, everyone knows, and they're like, honey, shut up. And so, okay, so I had no idea what this was. For those of you who don't know, my boss walked me over to, I had this enormous L-shaped desk, and on one side of it was a typewriter, an enormous typewriter that I couldn't figure out how to turn on, just to sort of, before we get to the dictaphone. It took an extremely long time. I was like drenched in sweat before someone finally came over and showed me how to turn it on. That's how large it was. It had been manufactured in approximately 1975, and this was 1996. And it sort of hummed like a car. It was a very sort of outdated machine. But the dictaphone was sort of a cutting edge piece of office technology in maybe like the early 1960s, and it essentially was a tape recorder and that didn't have any buttons on it. So she showed me this. She takes the plastic cover off of this thing that looks kind of like a white plastic dome with nothing on it, no markings, and was like, here you go. And it turns out that, of course, what it is, you know, a way of kind of freeing secretaries from having to take shorthand. So my boss would go into her office and kind of dictate letters, and then she would hand me the cassette tapes. I would put them in the dictaphone, and her voice would kind of, I had these huge headphones. This is before huge headphones were cool. And I would put on the huge headphones and hear her voice coming at me from them as if she were God. And then I would type the letters, which were actually usually extremely boring. So, so this is my first day, and the other thing you should know is that I had been sent to this agency by a headhunter, by a publishing placement agency that I think no longer exists because now everything is all online, but then was the agency that sort of placed all assistants at publishing houses, literary agencies, and I ended up at this headhunting firm really by accident. And just thinking, hey, that might be an okay thing to do. I've dropped out of grad school. Sure, I'll take a job in publishing if someone will hire me. Not really thinking that anyone would. And the headhunter said to me, actually, there are no jobs right now. It was right before Christmas. And I said, okay. And I wasn't expecting any. We were in the middle of a recession. No one I knew had a job. And went home, and the phone rang 2 seconds later, and she said, I have a potential job for you. How would you feel about working at a literary agency? And I said, great, because I had no idea what a literary agency was. Literally no idea, zero ideas. I was like, okay. So she sort of gave me a briefing about she assumed that I knew what a literary agency was. All of you know what a literary agency is, right? Yes, okay. No? Okay, a literary agency, so a literary agent is basically a person who's kind of the middleman between a writer and a publisher. And so I write a book, a novel, and an agent takes me on as his or her client and then sells that novel to a publisher. So an agent's job is kind of to represent her client's rights. The agent that I worked for, we'll get to this in a second, was an agent who was primarily what's known as a curatorial agent, which is to say that all of her clients were dead. So, and this agency was founded in the 1920s. It was one of the first, it was actually, there's sort of a battle going on between them, they still exist to this day, and another agency about which is the oldest literary agency in New York. They may be equally old. They may have been founded the same year. One might be like 3 days older than the other. In a way, the founder of this agency invented the practice of literary agenting. And they represented a lot of the great writers of the Jazz Age, you know, F. Scott Fitzgerald being a big one, but a lot of the great writers of the Harlem Renaissance, Langston Hughes, they represented Dylan Thomas, Agatha Christie, big writers, but all of them dead. And so their money came from estates, but a lot of these works that were bringing in money were falling out of copyright, so they were really kind of drowning, and they were kind of clinging to Salinger like a life raft, because he was alive, and like maybe he was working on a new novel, but his books were still bringing in lots and lots of money. So, okay, but to just, I'll tell you about the typing, and then I will actually read something, because there is actually a book. It's not just me talking. Okay. The headhunter lady said to me, this agent that I'm sending you in to interview with, she's been trying to find an assistant for months. I've been sending her people. She keeps rejecting them. She's known as being kind of difficult. And I of course was like, that's okay. My mom is really difficult. I totally get it. I like, this might be the perfect job for me. And she was like, I had a feeling. I don't know. I was like, what is it about me that says I had a really difficult mom? If my mom is watching this on YouTube, I love you and you're the best. I don't know if my mom knows what YouTube is, but anyway. Okay. So she, but then the next thing she said to me was, she's going to ask you if you can type and you need to lie. And I said, I can't type. And she was like, I know, no one your age can type. But you have to lie. Just tell her that you can type. And So, but, you know, I was sort of like, well, what do I do when I get the job? She was like, don't worry about it. It'll be fine. Just tell her you can type. And it didn't occur to me to ask, why do I need to know how to type? And then, of course, I got there on this first day, and there was something glaringly missing from the desk, and that thing was a computer. So all correspondence and everything at this office was typed down to like these weird little index cards that we used to record all transactions, where you had to type giant names of publishers into little tiny spaces, and there were special tubes of whiteout for all the different colors of these index cards, and oh my God, it was enough to make a person crazy, and they still do that to this day. Okay, so now to the actual book. So basically what's happened right before this moment is I've spent the entire morning typing. My boss has been sitting in her office smoking. So she chain smoked. She smoked, I want to say like 3 packs a day. She just smoked all day. And my desk was right outside of her office. And I did not smoke. And I think I was high. Anyway, something was happening to my brain. I was also waiting for someone because I'd never had a real job before. I'd worked at like The Gap. And I'd worked for my dad, but I was waiting for someone to say to me, it's lunchtime, you know, punch out your card and go to lunch or something, but nobody said that. And so it's finally in the middle of the afternoon, someone came by and said, hey, go to lunch now. And I was like, are you sure she's not gonna like eat me if I leave? And they were like, no. My boss was kind of scary, said no. So here's what happens. Okay. Out on Madison, I found myself gazing through the windows of a chain sandwich shop. Its wares too much for me, because everything was too much for me. I had nothing. A few dollars my father had slipped me meant to last until my first paycheck, which I presumed would come at the end of the week. I didn't even have a bank account in New York yet. I had so little money, there seemed no point. My account in London was still open, and there was some cash in it, but I wasn't sure how much or how to access it in this pre-electronic era. My wallet held 2 credit cards, but these I reserved for emergencies, and it didn't occur to me that I might use them for anything but, that I might use them for something as unnecessary as lunch, no matter how hungry I was. I decided, simply buy a cup of coffee and an apple, a couple of dollars at most. On the west side of Madison, I turned into a deli and inspected a vast pile of overripe bananas. What you like, called the white-clad man behind the sandwich counter, smiling. Turkey on a hard roll, I said, without really intending to, my heart beating with the recklessness of this gesture. Provolone, lettuce, tomato, and just a little mayo and mustard. At the register, I handed over a 10 and was given $2 and 2 quarters back, several dollars more than I'd expected to spend on so humble a sandwich. My pulse quickened with regret. $5 was lunch. $7.50 was dinner. Back at my desk, I set down my sandwich and slipped off my coat. As I pulled out my chair to sit down, my boss appeared in the doorway to her office. Oh, good. You're back, she said. Come in and have a seat. We have some things to talk about. Glancing sadly at my sandwich, wrapped tightly in white butcher paper, I walked into her office and sat down in one of the straight-backed chairs that faced her desk. So, she said, settling in her own chair behind that vast expanse of a desk, we need to talk about Jerry. I nodded, though I had no idea who Jerry was. People are going to call and ask for his address, his phone number. They're going to ask you to put them in touch with him. Or me. She laughed at the ridiculousness of this. Reporters will call. Students. Graduate students. She rolled her eyes. They'll say they want to interview him or give him a prize or an honorary degree or who knows what. Producers will call about the film rights. They'll try to get around you. They may be very persuasive, very manipulative, but you must never... Behind those huge, heavy glasses, her eyes narrowed, and she leaned across the desk like a caricature of a gangster, her voice taking on a frightening edge. Never, never, never give out his address or phone number. Don't tell them anything. Don't answer their questions. Just get off the phone as quickly as possible. Do you understand? I nodded. Never, ever, ever are you to give out his address or phone number. I understand, I told her, though I wasn't sure I did. as I didn't know who Jerry was. This was 1996, and the first Jerry that came to mind was Seinfeld, who presumably wasn't a client of the agency, though one never knew, I supposed. "Okay," she said, sitting back in her chair. "You understand. Now, go. I'm going to take a look at your correspondence." As I left her office, smoothing my skirt, I happened to glance at the bookcases directly to the right of her doorway, on the wall opposite the side of my desk that held the typewriter. I'd been staring at that bookcase all day, staring at it without seeing it, so focused was I on my typing. The case held books in corresponding hues, mustard, maroon, turquoise, imprinted with bold black type. I'd seen these books countless times, in my parents' bookcase and the English department closet at my high school, at every bookstore and library I'd ever visited, and, of course, in the hands of friends. I'd never read them, myself, due at first purely to happenstance, then to conscious choice. Books so ubiquitous on the contemporary bookshelf I barely noticed them. The Catcher in the Rye, Franny and Zoe, Nine Stories. Salinger. The agency represented J.D. Salinger. I'd reached my desk before it hit me. "Oh," I thought, "that Jerry." Okay. So the next day, after this incident, my boss called me back into her office and basically said, "There's more we need to talk about with regard to Jerry. So some people take this job and they think he's going to become their best friend. They think he's going to call all the time and they're going to kind of get to know him and they're going to be like..." I mean, this is not at all how she said it. I'm paraphrasing, obviously. She would never use the term "like." She said, you know, they think that they're going to send him their novel. You know, and that's never going to happen. First of all, he's never going to call. Secondly, if by some crazy chance he does call, he's going to be put through directly to me. He would never be put through to someone as lowly as you. You're never going to speak to him. Just get that out of your mind. And of course, meanwhile, I hadn't known what a literary agency was, and I didn't know that Salinger was a client. I suppose now, if you were interviewing for a job at this agency and you were 23, you would just Google the agency and discover this right away, but this was a different time. So, I mean, during this year, just to give you some context, 1996, during the year that I worked there, that was the Times launched their website. And I remember when they launched it and looking at it online, like trying to find, there's a scene here where I go to the Times website and for the first time try to look up some information. And it was like slowly loading. It was like ka-chunk, ka-chunk, ka-chunk. And I was like, is this worth it? Like, should I, you know, it was like 10 minutes later, my search results loaded. So anyway. Okay, so she said, you know, you're never going to speak to Salinger, and he's never going to call. And an hour later, he called. And so it turned out that she wasn't lying to me. None of this was untrue. But this year that I worked there turned out to be a really unusual year for Salinger and an unusual year for the agency because Salinger decided that he wanted to publish a new book. So you can imagine what a big deal this was. Not a book that he had just written, but a standalone version of a short story of his from 1968? Three? Oh my God, I should know this. I used to know this. Anyway, from the 60s, called Hapward 16, 1929. A 60-page short story. So, and he, a small publisher in Virginia, had approached him 8 years earlier about putting out this edition of the book, and he had been thinking about it for 8 years. And for some reason, the day after I started this job, he decided, today is the day I want to do this. I'm going to go forward with this. So suddenly, he was in much closer contact with my boss. It wasn't like he was it wasn't like he was calling all the time, but he was more present as an actual human being rather than a kind of like God figure who kept the agency afloat. So anyway, a month or two later, here's what happens. How many times had I been told that Salinger would not call, would never call, that I would have no contact with him? More than I could count. And yet, one morning, a Friday, at the beginning of April, I picked up the phone and heard someone shouting at me, "Hello! Hello!" Then something incomprehensible. "Hello! Hello!" More gibberish. Slowly, as in a dream, the gibberish resolved into language. "It's Jerry," the caller was shouting. "Oh my God," I thought, "it's him." I began slightly to quiver with fear, not because I was talking to or being shouted at by the actual J.D. Salinger, but because I so feared doing something wrong and incurring my boss's wrath. My mind began to sift through all the Salinger-related instructions that had been imparted to me, but they had more to do with keeping others away from him, less to do with the man himself. There was no risk of my asking him to read my stories or gushing about The Catcher in the Rye. I still hadn't read it. "Who is this?" he asked, though it took me a few tries to understand. "It's Joanna," I told him 9 or 10 times, yelling at the top of my lungs by the final three. "I'm the new assistant." "Well, nice to meet you, Suzanne," he said, finally, in something akin to a normal voice. "I'm calling to speak to your boss." I had assumed as much. Why had Pam put him through to me rather than taking a message? My boss was out for the day, it being Friday, her reading day. I conveyed this to him. Or I'm sure you guys are familiar with the concept of the reading day, which in publishing, many agents and editors stay home on Fridays to read. But in the case of my boss, who wasn't necessarily taking on existing clients, their reading was done. There were times I know when reading was done. She would come in on Monday and be like, "I read this." So, okay. Anyway, I conveyed this to him, or hoped that I did. "I can call her at home and have her call you back today, or she can give you a call when she gets in on Monday." "Monday is fine," he said. "Well, very nice to meet you, Suzanne. I hope we meet in person someday." "Me too," I said. "Have a great day." This was not a phrase I ever used. Where had it come from? "You too." I put the phone down and took a deep breath, as I'd learned to do in ballet. My entire body, I realized, was shaking. I stood up and stretched. "Jerry?" asked Hugh. So this is a person who, I'll just explain, occupied a very strange place in the agency's hierarchy and mechanism, sort of in the inner workings of the agency. He was a sort of senior figure at the agency. He'd worked there for 20 plus years, but he was not an agent. He was this kind of, I don't want to say pathologically, but extraordinarily quiet, reclusive man who appeared to live at the office. He was a little bit like something out of Dickens. He had an office near mine, and I would arrive for work. No matter how early I arrived, he was there in his office doing something, frantically typing, or just eating a peanut butter sandwich. Whenever I left, he was still there. And I knew that he had a wife and he had stepchildren and he had ostensibly an apartment in Brooklyn Heights somewhere, but there was no sign of this anywhere. Like, he just seemed to live at the agency. And his role was that of kind of the agency archivist. So you can see all these years later, I loved this man. You could say to him, "So somebody just called about this Fitzgerald story, and they couldn't remember, the person couldn't remember the name of it, and she wasn't sure where it was published or when. She wants to include it in an anthology of stories, you know, about giraffes and adultery." And he would be like, "You know, that was published in the Saturday Review this week, and he was paid $200 for it." Like, he had the whole history of the agency in his brain. But he also knew everything about, like, every bit of weird, outdated office equipment, and he could fix anything. You know, he could be like, "The telex machine, here's why it's not working." And so he was a little bit like, I don't know, if I were 20, I would be like, he was my spirit animal at the agency. He was my spirit guide. But he was the person who, whenever, you know, sort of watched over me, and was very kind. "Jerry?" asked Hugh, stepping out of his office with a mug of coffee. "Yes," I said. "Wow." "He's deaf," he told me. "His wife set up this special phone for him with an amplified receiver, but he refuses to use it." Hugh sighed his trademark sigh. To be Hugh was to be let down by the world. "What did he want?" "Just to talk to my boss," I shrugged. "I offered to call her at home and have her call him back, but he said Monday was fine." Hugh wrinkled his face in thought. "Why don't you call her anyway? I think she'd want to know." "Okay," I said, thumbing through my Rolodex. She wasn't home. and she had no answering machine. She didn't believe in them, just as she didn't believe in computers or voicemail, another newfangled invention not employed by the agency. If you called during business hours, you reached Pam, the receptionist. If you called outside business hours, the phone just rang and rang, as it did at my boss's apartment, 20 blocks north of the office. I tried again every hour or so until the end of the day, to no avail. Even for Jerry, it would have to be Monday. Okay. Susan, tell me, should I read one more short section or should we move to questions? Okay. Okay, so one other component of this, of the book, there are several different threads to the story, but is that this same man, Hugh, we'll just call him my spirit guide again, came over because I've been watching too much Girls, thinking like, I'm going to be your crack spirit guide. Anyway, so one day, it was maybe February, I'd been there a month or so, walked over to my desk carrying like an enormous pile of letters. They were kind of letters all bundled together, some packages, you know, bearing stamps from all over the world, you know, some really beat up letters that you could tell had traveled pretty far, dumps them on my desk and says, oh, by the way, these are the Salinger letters. You need to answer them. We forgot to mention this before. There are some more in my office. They've been sitting around for a few months. I'll get them later. I was like, the Salinger letters? And he said, the letters from fans, from Salinger's fans. You know, they come. He doesn't want to see them. They come to us and you have to answer them. It's like, oh, okay. So I can just say whatever I want? And he like had a heart attack. And then when he recovered, he's like, no, there's a form letter. I'll get it for you. So we went, you know, back to his office. I failed to mention that his desk, he was the sort of person who had a desk that was covered in papers. And I'm not actually exaggerating when I say that when he was sitting in his chair, you could not see his head. It was that high. But he could pluck anything from it, like anything at all. And I feel like there's a particular type of brain that works that way. And again, I'm totally in awe of this. So he went to his desk, plucked a paper from the pile, came back to me with this piece of paper, which was, okay, this is like the dictaphone carbon paper, carbon copies. We all remember, well, not all of us. I can tell some of you don't. I can see some people in there. So the office, this agency, had only recently acquired a photocopy machine. So until about 3 years before, they had still been using carbon paper. So you had to keep copies of every single letter, everything you typed, and you did it using carbon paper. And the carbon would imprint on this special paper that was yellow. It was almost this color, actually, this bright yellow paper that was really pulpy and kind of dissolved in your fingers. And so I was constantly told how lucky I was that I didn't have to use carbon paper and how like all the assistants of my era were really spoiled because we got to use the photocopier. So he came back with this yellowed sheet of paper. The edges were brown. And when I say that they were crumbling, I mean that they were actually crumbling. The date on it was 1963. And it was a form letter that basically said, "Dear Salinger fan, thank you so much for your letter to J.D. Salinger. As you probably know, Mr. Salinger does not wish to see mail from his fans. Thus, we cannot pass on your kind letter to him. No, please just go away and leave us alone. Do not follow up on this correspondence because we're not going to respond to you. If you call, we will hang up on you. And, you know, we're not going to give you any information about Salinger. Don't show up at our office because we will have you escorted out by the FBI. It's happened. Go away." So, it was a really off-putting letter. It also, and I'm not fully capturing this, was very much written in the kind of formal language of the 1960s. This is 1996, you know, the era in which like email had already kind of taken over. And I felt like, wow, I have to type this like 100 times a day. I said, you know, there's no 100 times a day typing it over and over again. So he left and I immediately ripped open all the letters and read them frantically in like a crazed rage. And, after I did that, he came back and said, "Oh, by the way, you don't really need to read them." And I was like, "Oh, okay, I won't." And he said, "You need to glance at them because, you know, crazy people send death threats to Salinger. So if we get any of those, we do actually have to report them to the FBI, or that, you know, because of things that I'm sure, you know, you don't need me to tell you about, like with crazed killers, you know, assassinating people, saying that it was because of The Catcher in the Rye. So in case there's anything like that, I needed to sort of glance at them, but I didn't need to actually read them. I would only realize later, and in the section that you're about to read, you'll understand why I say this, that he was trying to save me from myself. So, okay. So basically, I sent this form letter a zillion times, and then one day, this happened. The next morning, I turned to the letters straight away. There were the usual proclamations of love for Holden, the usual war stories, the usual stories of despair and redemption, the many, many letters from Denmark and the Netherlands and Japan. The Japanese loved Holden. I tapped out a few form responses and modified form responses. So I started sort of softening the letter in situations where I felt like it was inappropriate to send, to sound so mean. Like, for instance, there were many letters saying, like, my child died last year in a car crash, and I turned to Salinger's work in the wake of her death. And you felt like, really? I'm really going to send this letter to, you know, so I would tweak it to say, like, we are so sorry for your loss, you know, and that kind of thing. Okay. I filed away a few tragic letters for another day, then slit open an envelope addressed in bubbly, girlish script. The letter was almost a novella unto itself, this girl's story unfolding over 3 pages of wrinkly, pencil-smudged notebook paper. She was a freshman in high school, she explained, and she hated school, particularly English class, which she was failing. Her English teacher was maybe an all right person, but she didn't understand what it meant to be young, and she assigned the class these stupid books that had nothing to do with their lives. The only book the girl had liked was, of course, The Catcher in the Rye. As things stood, she was going to have to go to summer school or repeat freshman English, which would be so embarrassing she wasn't sure if she could stand it, and her mother would kill her. The year was almost over, but she'd asked her teacher if she could do anything at all to bring her grade up, just enough so that she'd pass. There is something you can do, the teacher told her. Write a letter to J.D. Salinger and make it good enough that he'll write back. If he writes back, I'll give you an A. There's a tactic. I thought, putting the letter down and staring for the millionth time at the wall of Salinger books. It was lunchtime, and I had a neat stack of letters ready to be mailed. I ran them through the postal meter, threw on my coat, and slipped the girl's letter in my bag. Online to buy my salad, I read it again. Despite various misspellings and sloppy penmanship, this girl wasn't a terrible writer. She conveyed her story vividly and honestly, with passion and detail. And then there was the pure audacity, the ballsiness, the brattiness of writing to J.D. Salinger and saying, please respond so I can get a free A. I kind of liked her. Salinger had been a terrible student himself. Perhaps he would like her too. I really need this A, I read, holding my plastic container of watery lettuce. It will bring my entire GPA up to passing. My mother is mad at me all the time now. I know you understand. And yet, there was something that rankled me about the letter. What would Salinger say to her? I pondered this as I walked back to the office, across 49th and down Madison, the sun warming my bare arms. Salinger had failed out of schools himself. I knew this from the letters, many of which referred to incidents in Salinger's life. They could actually be informative, the letters. Holden, I knew, too, had failed out of some schools. Would either of them have attempted to maintain his place through this kind of trick? I hadn't read Catcher, so I wasn't sure about Holden, but I knew that Salinger would not. He would have taken his failure as deserved. Back at my desk, I ate the olive off my salad, then turned toward the Selectric and banged out a response to the girl, suggesting that it was decidedly not in the spirit of Holden, or Salinger, to be worrying about grades or her mother's anger. If she wanted to be like Holden or Salinger, she should accept her failing grade, a grade she, by her own admission, deserved. Trying to trick herself into a grade she hadn't earned was a coward's way out, I wrote, a phony's way out. If you desire an A, or at least a passing grade, there's only one way to earn it. You must study and do the work assigned to you. This might mean making up papers or tests. This might mean begging your teacher to give you another chance. This might mean apologizing or otherwise humbling yourself. But it is the only way. An A earned by trickery means absolutely nothing. As I signed the letter with my name, my heart raced happily. I had done the right thing. I was mastering the art of what would Salinger say. But I had also crossed a line, the barely visible seam between bemused interest or compassionate engagement or plain sympathy and utter over-involvement. Why could I not leave these letters alone? I asked myself as I walked over to the mail meter. Why could I not just send on form letters to every single fan? The answer was plain. I loved them. They were exciting. When I read them, sitting at my desk alone on, say, a Friday morning, I felt a strange charge, a mixture of anger and affection, disdain and empathy, admiration and disgust. These people were writing to me, or to Salinger, care of me, about their marital frustrations, their dead children, their boredom and desperation. They wrote about their favorite songs and poems, about the trips they'd taken to the Grand Canyon and Hawaii, about their favorite dolls. They told me, or Salinger, things I knew for sure they'd never told anyone else. Could I over and over respond to them in the most formal and personal manner possible? Could I just abandon them? Could I let them think that no one cared, no one was listening? Okay, thank you guys. Yeah, should I step aside?
No,
okay.
Stay where you
okay,
are.
I'll stay.
Somebody will go to the mic.
I'll go to the mic. Oh my god. Oh, there's another mic. Okay, I get it now.
This mic, yeah.
Yeah, I'm not going to push you out of the way at your mic. I guess I suspect other people are wondering, too. So you said the agency is still in existence. Did you have any issues? Did you worry about what they thought? Is Hugh still there? Hugh is still there, and my boss is still there. She's in her 80s. And in a strange coincidence, my first book, A Fortunate Age, was published by Scribner, which is the publisher, which is Fitzgerald's publisher. And part of the reason that I chose them, I had to choose publishers, and I chose them in part because I was like, Fitzgerald, is it Scribner? And I felt this sort of sentimental, sort of, you know, nostalgic something for them, which is actually a bad way to make what's essentially a business decision, but that's a whole other story. So my editor at Scribner was actually the person who oversaw the Fitzgerald estate and worked with my old boss. So I would hear these stories about her during my time at Scribner. You know, she definitely did not become any less kind of like feisty and cranky as she aged, but I didn't have any problems with them at all. I haven't had any response. I've had responses from people who were at the agency when I worked there but left. Like there's a character who's known as Max, and a few other people who actually aren't even in the book but were there when I was there, and they left, saying, "Oh my God, you really got it right." From the people who are still there, I haven't heard anything, but years and years back, I wrote an essay about this, and Hugh wrote to me at the time and said, your boss read it, and she was really tickled by it. So, hi.
Hi. I was wondering a little bit about your writing process for this. Did you have journals from that time period that helped you, or is this sort of all based on your recollections looking back?
It's a mixture of both. So I was a meticulous keeper of journals. I wrote in my journal for, oh my God, probably at least an hour a day during this year, every day. And I also wrote piles and piles of letters to friends. In that moment, sort of when you've just finished college, your friends are spread out all over. So it was like I had my friend who was in the Peace Corps in Tajikistan, you know, and my friend who was in Japan, and everyone didn't have email. And there was some emailing, but I was writing letters all the time. And friends of mine, as I've toured all over the country and the world, people have come and said, I have your letters written on the agency's letterhead that you wrote to me. All of that is to say that when I was writing this, I didn't have any of those documents. Like, I didn't have my letters that I wrote because I didn't keep carbon copies. If I had, I would have. That would have been so much easier. I'm not going to explain why I didn't have my journals, but suffice it to say, I didn't have my journals from that period. However, this year, so I wrote about this year. I wrote this very long, something like somewhere between like 6,000 and 10,000 word essay about this year, that's very different in style than the book, in about 2002. So not that long after it happened. So that, I think, contributed that I was writing that it was still relatively fresh. But basically, that essay aside, there's a way in which the events of this year were so sort of, to use a really cliched term, kind of crystalline in my memory. And I think there are a couple of reasons for it, but one is that I wrote every single thing down. So even though I didn't have access to it, it somehow the act of writing it down, and there is actually, I'm writing something about memory now that's very different than this. And when you look at research and memory, it is in fact true that when you write things down, you remember them better. Like often, I used to do a lot of acting badly, and and what one of my teachers, especially when we were doing Shakespeare, instructed us to write, copy out all our lines over and over again because it really helps you remember them. So I do really feel that sort of writing so much. I was very alone during this year, you know, so I was constantly sort of writing everything down. I think that it sort of embedded it in my memory. But the other thing I wanted to mention is that I did also spend a whole year researching the book, which sounds strange because it's a book about me. Sort of about me. I mean, it's partly about me, but everyone who's a character in the book, except for my boss, I interviewed sometimes multiple times. I interviewed many, many people who are not characters in the book, but who either worked at the agency at different times, worked there when I was there, worked with the agency. I interviewed the friends that I saw on a really regular basis during that time. I revisited as many of the places that are locations in the book as I could. So a lot went into it. It wasn't just my being like, did this happen? You know?
Thank you.
Sure.
I'm wondering two things. So just want to make sure that you have since read The Catcher in the Rye at some point.
Yes. In the year of this book, if you read the book, you'll see like about 9 months into my time there, I read it.
Okay. And did you meet him?
I did meet him, yes.
So we'll have to like read the book for it.
But it gives you something to look forward to, maybe?
Great,
anyway,
okay. So thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.